should get to it.
Yep.
Back. I'm going to be hanging out with you guys, and then you guys probably saying, oh, I got stuck with Mr. Bean at the Ricki Lake Show. It's going to happen.
Oh, they canceled.
So we're going to hang out and meet some amazing guests and amazing topics that we're going to talk about, and of course, our amazing folks, Ricki Lake. Are you guys excited to meet Ricki? How many of you guys have been watching the show? Ricki Lake on 3 p.m. every afternoon here in LA on Fox. So it's awesome that you guys support the show. We're online, thericklakeshow.com. You guys can follow the show and find out when this episode is going to air. I hit this one because the other one's TV.
Sam, I'm going to go
today. It's going to be on the LF. And for those who were here for the first show, know this. I'm the guy that gives out all of the free stuff to the audience. And I give the stuff to the most loud and energetic audience member. Show them what we got. First show, a couple people came back. They loved it so much. But a whole new level, ladies and gentlemen.
I'll give that back to you. I don't know what you
We're going
to
get this party starting right now. All right, everybody get up on your feet right now. Let's get this party. Let's get the energy. It's cold in here. I want to put the energy. I'm going to raise the roof on this place. Jump away. All you know this. I'm gonna bring up my buddy Ronald to come out on stage. This man rocked. Come on up over here. This is the leader of the Cupid Shuffle right over here. He's bringing up a partner right now. You guys know how to do the Cupid Shuffle.
Have a great show.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ricki Lake!
thing. So we're gonna get started. You're not shy. How many of you are here at Flash Show? You have that much fun. You came back from Mars.
Let's blow the roof off this place. Here we go, guys.
Started speaking publicly in favor of medical cannabis during her own battle with ovarian cancer. Nice to see you, Cheryl. Thank you for being here. Tell us what happened after you were diagnosed.
I was diagnosed with ovarian cancer on December 18th, 2006. My Western medical doctors told me to prepare for the end, to start preparing for my cremation and my memorial service, so that's what I did. I went into immediate surgery, and when I was in hospice care waiting to die on 27 pharmaceuticals on intravenous hormone pumps, a friend of mine came to rescue me from the hospital. We signed out against medical advice. My friend carried me out and said, if you're going to take me out to the pond, I were going to get some medical cannabis.
And how has that changed your life? I mean, you're still here. It's 2006, so that's how many years have you survived? You're still,
4 years.
You're living still with this disease.
Yes. When you find out that you're dying, I mean, you'll basically reach out for anything. So I learned through Dr. William Courtney and a number of other specialists in endocannabinoid medicine about juicing the plant, using cannabis-infused cooking, the raw food diet, CBD, CBN, THCs.
Okay, this is way, way, way too much information. But
well, the doctors are
saying it's stone. But we all think of marijuana. This is a very different thing than just wasting away and getting like Cheech and Chong stone.
I was one of those
people. We all have that visual.
I was one of those people. I'm one of those people. I've never tried cocaine. I've never taken a pill. I've never smoked a cigarette. When they first told me about marijuana, I was like, are you kidding? I'm not a stoner. That's not what I do. But then when I tried it and I started feeling better, within 30 days, I was off of the intravenous morphine cup. I was able to walk. I was able to shower for the very first time myself. And it was a gift. And then I learned about the juicing and the oils. And in fact, the cannabis oil that I use that's provided by Dr. Janice Sweeney with the Phoenix Tears Foundation is the same exact oil and the same foundation that I work with. They saved my life. And now I act as a spokesperson representing other patients across the country and other products across the country. That's why they call me the Martha Stewart of marijuana, because I decided to...
That's a perfect description for you.
I just wanted to learn everything that I could about saving my life and saving other people's lives and put a mainstream face on it because it will become more.
So you were being treated with morphine and other major opiates. What was the feeling like versus what it's like treating yourself with cannabis?
I was taking 27 different pharmaceuticals. I was on an intravenous morphine pump, and most of my medication was administered intravenously. I was basically a vegetable. I had a colostomy and a catheter. I couldn't go to the bathroom by myself. I couldn't shower by myself. By using alternative treatments with cannabis oils, cannabis juices, within 90 days, I was not only able to walk and talk again, but I'm working full time and have a number of companies that I work with representing development products.
The sign in the background. One, two, three.
Okay. effect, benefit versus side effects. And there has been a ban and lack of research on the use of cannabis in young people. And there's a great deal of evidence that the initiation of cannabis in youth alters brain function. It's benefit to risk.
But with all due respect, I mean, if you're getting a prescription, if a cancer patient, 74 or 70, is being also treated with opiates like morphine and oxycodone, don't you agree that there's the dependency issue with those drugs?
I think it's
one
drug problem in the street with is opiates. So that's why I say I'm going to buy the book. Our society is rampant with misprescribing. The biggest drug that's misprescribed in our society is the opiates. So I have to stand by principles of appropriate prescribing, which is you have to look at benefit, risk, you have to do it.
Well, he is one of the one of America's most foremost experts on medical cannabis, heavily involved in this ongoing debate. Okay, jump right in, Dr. Here.
Well, I certainly agree that you need to do a risk analysis. We take a look at therapeutic benefits versus the risk. And I think you have to be very cautious when you're doing the risk. I am reluctant, mainly for public relations reasons, to see people under the age of 25, but I do from time to time. And I know, for instance, in this instance, that you have a lot of potential benefit, and I think the risk is very low. I will criticize the United States government, and I will criticize the President of the United States, who said that he was going to rely on science, and he stood firmly in the way of science. We certainly need more research, but right now we have a 7-year-old girl that has cancer. And the risks, I think, from the use of cannabis for the side effects of cancer and to treat the cancer, what people don't realize is that there are at least 15 different cell types in tissue culture and in mice that are responsive, that are killed by cannabis. It prevents angiogenesis, that is, new blood cells from forming. It promotes apoptosis, that is, the death of older cells and cancerous cells. And it interferes with metastasis. There was some research done up in Dr. Smith's backyard in San Francisco on breast cancer, in which this was done with mice. So, I mean, the mouse has breast cancer, we can cure it with cannabis, but I'd like to see it done with
Why aren't they doing it? Why aren't they testing it scientifically and documenting?
Because the United States government, since at least 1937, hasn't listened to the American Medical Association. A lot of people don't realize that the Marijuana Tax Act had nothing to do with marijuana and everything to do with hemp. And the AMA testified against it. In 2009, the AMA said, this should be rescheduled so we can study this as we would any other drug. And Dr. Smith and I were talking about this in the green room, and we absolutely agreed that more research, good research, is needed. And one of the things I want to comment on in terms of this couple here, they are trying to use standard dosing, and that's something that as doctors we would like to see happen. My father was a pharmacist. He went.
Mine too.
You too. All right, let's talk about that. And I think my dad is probably older than your dad. Young, whatever. A century. And in 1928, when he was in the University of Minnesota School of Pharmacy, one of their assignments was to make tincture of cannabis. And he said, and we have to be very careful because the alcohol was illegal. And the point is that in the 1920s, doctors in the United States of America wrote 3 million prescriptions a year, on average, containing cannabis. We know how to use cannabis in this country medically, but because of our government standing in the way and trying to practice medicine without a license, we have these kinds of intrigue that we have to have a show like this that tries to hold their feet to the fire of the powers that be.
Very quickly, Cheryl, things are changing. Do you feel like a shift? Is it definitely on Washington?
Things are absolutely changing. Washington and Colorado both just legalized for recreational use, and we're really reaching a tipping point right now. We speak to many experts, especially people who are from the law that are in 2016, has been higher involved, and we are at the tipping point right now.
Well, I have to say, I'm so proud to be doing the show to have the conversation, and I thank you, Mykayla's parents, for being here and talking to me about your not so straight and narrow treatment. So thank you so much. Appreciate it. When we come back, you will meet another brave little girl who's become an important force in my own life. Can't wait for you to meet her. We'll be right back.
And I know what the in crowd goes.